Welcome to the Anamena video tutorial, Unit 5-4. Deflectometry of parabolic troughs collectors, evaluation and results. My name is Christoph Prahl. I've been working for 5 years at DLR in the CSP fields, optical measurement of concentrator shape and collector development. The issue of this unit is deflectometry, parabolic trough collectors, evaluation and results. The content is to get an overview about the evaluation steps using the DLR evaluation macro written in MATLAB. This software is not commercially available. We also have a look on several examples of typical results. The objectives of this unit are that you get an insight in the most important evaluation steps and that you understand the importance of good measurement raw data and a good documentation. You also will learn how to read and interpret the results. A complete TAMAS evaluation basically consists of the creation of a configuration file based on the measurement documentation, the image analysis and processing, the geometric calculation of surface normals from the images and the setup information, and the post-processing and visualization of the results. Before having a look at the single steps of the evaluation procedure, let's resume the TAMAS measurement principle. The TAMAS measure principle is based on a deflectometry measurement and as a pattern serves the absorber tube. So we use the reflection of the edge of the absorber tube to obtain the slope at the point of reflection. From the position of the camera, the position of the reflection and the position of the absorber tube edge, we can calculate the local slope and compare this value to the design value. With the TAMAS measurement principle, we can obtain only slope deviations in curvature direction. Let's have an overview of the evaluation procedure. From the documentation images, we have to determine the absorber tube position and its deviation in X and Z direction from the focal line. For this evaluation, we use the documentation images and the offset measurements using the hook. We also have to determine the camera position from the laser distance measurement. All these values are put in a configuration file, which is then used by the evaluation macro. When the evaluation starts, the lens distortion and their influence on the images is corrected. Some manual input is required during the evaluation, so the user has to select the corner of the modules and adjust the thresholds. It is not possible that the rest of the evaluation is completely automatic because disturbing areas in the image will cause outliers. These areas have to be cut manually by the user of the software. After rejecting all outliers, the software calculates the surface normal and determines slope errors by comparing the surface normals with the design values. From the slope errors, focus deviations can be calculated and also intercept values via ray tracing. Finally, the results are displayed in slope error maps, focus deviation maps, and intercept value maps together with the statistical results on a panel and module level. The first step of the evaluation procedure is to determine the absorber tube position in direction of the optical axis from the inclination of the absorber tube supports. From the known length of the absorber tube support and the angle between the mirror edge and the absorber tube support, we can calculate the height of that pivot point about the vertex. From the images of the absorber tube, which also show the glass envelope tube, the eccentricity of the absorber tube in the glass envelope tube is calculated, both in Z and X direction. Now that we have the exact position of the absorber tube relative to the focal line, we can start with the image processing. The first step of the image processing is to correct the lens distortion. We will switch between the raw image and the corrected one, and we see a small difference between these images. However, this correction is very important to obtain accurate results. In the next step, the user is asked to select the module edges in the images. So for each module, 4 edges have to be selected. From these edges, a spatial projection is calculated so that we obtain the ortho image of only the mirror surface of each module. In these pictures, you see the ortho image, so only the mirror surface is visible, but the background and the surroundings of the module are not visible anymore. In these images, you have to adjust the threshold to distinguish between reflex of the absorber tube and background. For different settings of the threshold, we see what area is identified as background and what area is identified as absorber tube. So this would be a good selection of the threshold because absorber tube reflex and background are well distinguished. The software now calculates from the reflex the position of the edge of each absorber tube. In this image, we see an enlarged fraction and each line corresponds to a single image. For each image and elevation angle, a color is assigned to the reflex line. We now see that there are some areas where wrong angles have been assigned as absorber tube reflex edge. These areas have to be removed to get proper results. After cutting out these areas, we end up with two maps, one for the upper edge and one for the lower edge of the absorber tube. These maps can now be used together with the setup information about the position of the camera and the position of the absorber tube relative to the concentrator surface to calculate the slope deviation at the position of the reflex. By interpolation, we get slope deviations also at positions where no reflex is visible. Again, we have here the option to cut out areas that do not match the pattern. An example result for such a slope deviation map looks like this. We have a geometry of a RP3 or so Eurotrough or LS3 collector. To each single mirror panel, statistical values are assigned for the slope deviation and curvature direction, and we also have one value characterizing the entire module. Blue areas mean that a reflected ray is passing below the focal line, and red areas mean that a reflected ray is crossing above the focal line. From the slope deviations, we can calculate slope focus deviation by taking into account the distance of the point of reflection to the focal line. Again, a statistical value can be assigned to the entire module. We have here a histogram of the focus deviation. When the histogram follows a Gaussian distribution, the statistical values can be used to estimate the intercept. In any case, it is recommended to do a ray tracing where also other concentrator errors and the sun shape are taken into account. From such an intercept map, we can estimate the intercept of the entire module. Let's now have a look at results for a good module with a normal Eurotrough geometry of an aperture width of approximately 6 meter and an absorber tube radius of 35 millimeter. Good values are an SDX below 2 milliradian and an FDX below 10 milliradian. Then we achieve an intercept factor of above 99%. For a bad module, shown in these images, the slope deviation and curvature direction is much higher, in the range of 9 milliradian, so the intercept factor is reduced to approximately 60%. Let's now summarize what we have learned in Unit 5.1 to 5.4. The measurement method deflectometry can be used to determine the optical performance of most CSP concentrators and mirrors. If you want to obtain the performance of parabolic trough collectors, in particular the optical performance, the absorber tube can be used as a pattern for deflectometric measurement. The measurement method is then called TARMS, Trough Absorber Reflex Measurement System. The software macros for the evaluation have been written in MATLAB. The source code is DLR property and not commercially available. However, you have now achieved the capabilities to perform the measurement and you can send the data to DLR experts which might do the evaluation for you.